great to see you. It's great to see you here in this quite remarkable lecture hall and see you waiting for a remarkable talk from our keynote speaker today. We are very happy that Cornelis de Brabander accepted Early's invitation to be one of our keynote speakers. Cornelis asked me to be brief, and your wish is my command, so I make it very, very short. Because I also think that his talk will speak for itself, and his capacities, his skills, and his theoretical work and his research. Cornelis started his life as a researcher in the mid-70s of the last century. For some of us, this is a big deal. At the University of Leiden. His first project was in self-responsible learning, and in this project they developed a method to promote self-responsible learning in close cooperations with teachers in secondary education. In his work, he was searching for concepts, and with the, I quote from himself, arrogance of the young, I like that in the video, he found all concepts inadequate, he found. So he developed his own theoretical model, and we will see a part of this model today. But the frustration with the incapability of the schools to implement, to enhance, to foster learning, self-responsible learning, led to the decision to leave the field of motivation at all. The frustration didn't take too long. Many years later, Rob Martens came to Leiden, and his enthusiasm brought Cornelis back to motivation, which led to the Early Outstanding Publication Award. Thanks, Rob, for that. A few words and a few more facts on Cornelis. He studied psychology at Leiden University. After graduation, he worked several years at the Leiden Interdisciplinary Center for Educational Research. In 1981, he became assistant professor at the Department of Education Studies of the University of Leiden, where he finished his PhD in 1990 on subject conceptions of secondary school teachers. In 2010, he became associate professor at the Open University of the Netherlands, and after his retirement, he remained connected as visiting lecturer both to the Department of Education Studies in Leiden and to the Welten Institute of the Open University of the Netherlands. His research topics, theories of motivation, educational conceptions of teachers, personal epistemology, professional development of teachers, educational ICT applications, and more. The title of Cornelis' keynote is A Unified Model of Task-Specific Motivation, and I would say, Cornelis, the stage is all yours.
Thank you, Marold, for your kind introduction. You said I had to speak for myself, but you have already done some of it. Thanks you all for coming. I apologize a bit for the problems I have posed for you in preparing this introduction. I know I'm a bit the odd man out. Some people have compared me with a saguaro. You know what a saguaro is? It's that giant cactus over there. And that produces only its first branch after 75 years. So I apologize for that. But not for being that, but for the problems I may have introduced. As Merle said, my entrance was in academic life was a project on self-responsible learning in school. It was typical for the 70s of the previous century. Maybe for those who wonder whether what self-responsible learning might have to do with self-regulation, self-regulation has the connotation of doing things independently, but these things are assignments for you. And self-responsible learning was, in my eyes, about developing and clarifying and fulfilling personal learning needs. So that's quite different. When Rob Martens came to work in Leiden, I had already been gone back to motivation, but we started a intensive cooperation. And Rob was at the time, I may say, a passionate follower of self-determination theory, and I was a bit skeptical about certain aspects. So, in hindsight, that was actually the starting point of the development of the unified model of task-specific motivation. My presentation has three parts. First, I will review the development of the model. Then, I will address some research we have done on the model. And in the third part, I will discuss the consequences for the further development of that model. Our goal was to develop a model that could integrate different theories of motivation. And to do that, there are all kinds of theories that have some overlap, but also have some conflicts, and we were looking at possibilities to integrate and to reconcile those conflicts. To do that, we focused on task-specific motivation, which we defined as readiness for action. That's a narrow definition. It tries to distinguish between motivation and motivators. It's readiness for action for a relatively specific activity. Activities can differ in size, but you should be able to pinpoint a specific activity. It can be, for instance, following a course, but following an educational track, that's too big. But we can discuss about that. And it's motivation at a specific point in time, which may be before, during, or after that activity. And we are looking at motivation at that point in time. And we asked, what are the constructs and their relations that are essential to describe task-specific motivation? What do we need to describe motivation in quantitative and qualitative respect adequately? The first problem we met was the relation between affect and cognition. Now, different theories have different emphasis on affect and cognition. But no theory, almost no theory, can escape from paying attention to that aspect that is not emphasized in that theory. Self-determination theory, for instance, says that fulfillment of basic needs of autonomy, competence, and relatedness lead to intrinsic motivation, which is liking to do an activity. That's opposed to extrinsic motivation, getting separable consequences. And in that theory, there is an elaborate structure of different types of extrinsic motivation. And some of them are less detrimental to intrinsic motivation than others, but they all diminish intrinsic motivation. Expectancy value theory of achievement motivation stresses subjective value, which are thoughts about outcome values. And they distinguish attainment value, to what extent is this outcome important for me as a person, utility value, what does it mean to other goals that I have. But sometimes people couldn't tell what they would attain from an activity, they just like to do that activity. So that became another aspect of subjective value, namely intrinsic value. The person-object theory of interest of Andreas Krapp distinguishes between feeling-related valences and value-related valences. Feeling-related valences are, again, feelings about doing an activity, and value-related valences are thoughts about outcome values. And these two types of valences originate from different systems of behavior regulation, one affective and the other cognitive. So now we have three possible relations between affect and cognition. They can be oppositional, they can be additive, or they can be independent. I'm trying to argue our case along three lines of reasoning, conceptual analysis, evidence from neuroimaging research, and evidence from empirical research into relations between the two. A conceptual analysis. I start with the definitions of self-determination theory, but that's just a starting point. Intrinsic motivation is doing an activity for its inherent satisfactions rather than for some separable consequence. Extrinsic motivation, doing an activity in order to attain some separable outcome. So we have two concepts to discuss: intrinsic inherent satisfactions and separable consequences. Inherent satisfactions. I like to play tennis personally. I very much like to do that. And what I like about that is the effort and the exertion that tennis requires, the run around on the court, to be able to place a ball exactly at a specific point on the court. I like to put my opponent on the wrong leg. I like to play with the people I'm playing with. So I could go on. There are all kinds of things I like. Now, inherent satisfaction is a plural, so that's what we see. It's not a unitary construct, but it's a composite of several elements. And these elements are cognitively distinguishable. But as soon as they are identified as such, they appear as extrinsic motivators. Satisfaction implies a need, and the satisfaction of that need is separable from the activity proper, if we could speak about the activity proper. So inherent satisfaction is not a useful construct to distinguish intrinsic from extrinsic motivation. What about separable consequences? Separable consequences may not play a role in motivation to be intrinsic. Is that ever possible? Think, for instance, about subconscious motives. Goal contagion is an example in this respect. Goal contagion is when an example of it is the teacher who is not very good at maintaining order in his classroom. And he runs the risk that suddenly in his class, the whole class bursts out in subversive activities. Now, do they do that because they like to? It's not actually coming from within, it's coming from outside. I have two maybe defining examples of separable consequences. The first is the true story of a friend of mine who was a gifted piano player and who, as an adolescent, spent hours and hours of piano practice. I have also played a bit piano, but I'm not very competent at it. And I know why. I did never rehearse. And he did. So I asked him how he managed to be so committed to his piano playing. And he confessed to me that as an adult, he realized that part of his stamina, of his effort, stemmed from a desire to impress women with his fabulous play. Now, there's no need to think he didn't like to play the piano. Of course he did. But his readiness for action was enhanced by his desire for contact with women. I come to him later. The second example is the separable consequence par excellence, money. And the example is in the stock, is about trading on the stock exchange. And there's nothing that stops a share broker to like his job very much. There's something to talk about it, to say about this, but it's still a separable consequences. So we draw two conclusions. You never know all separable consequences that play a role in task motivation. And they do not, by definition, impair motivation. So affective and cognitive components of motivation are simultaneous but disparate events. And they are not necessarily opposed, but they can have opposite effects. In neuroimaging research, it's used to talk about two regulation systems, which are supported by different brain structures. That difference gives them already some independence. And there is a reward and a motivation system, which resides roughly in subcortical regions. And then there is the cognitive control system that resides in cortical regions. And their independence is confirmed further by the fact that these two systems can be developmentally out of sync. So think, for instance, about adolescents who are not very good at thinking about their the consequence of their actions. So feelings about activities and thoughts about the value of their outcomes originate from different processes. Empirical evidence of the relations between the two. We find all kinds of relations between affect and cognition. They can be positive when activities are both pleasurable and profitable, or neither pleasurable nor profitable, which is what expectancy value theories have proven time after time. They can also be negative when activities are profitable but not pleasurable. And that again is proven by research in the realm of self-determination theory. And we all know from our educational experience that math can be boring, but you simply need it. So there was profit, but no pleasure. Activities can also be pleasurable, but not profitable, which is what a lot of parents think about television viewing or computer gaming. There is a peculiar fact in the meta-analysis within the realm of self-determination theory that show that verbal rewards that are experienced as autonomous supportive do not diminish less intrinsic motivation. They enhance intrinsic motivation substantially. So our conclusion is that affect and cognition are relatively independent. They are independent but interacting. On one hand, we have affective valences, which are feelings about doing an activity produced by an affective regulation system in an automatic response. You have no control, no conscious control over your feelings. Your feelings are there simply. You can manage some of your actions to mitigate your feelings or to produce more feelings, but feelings are there. They are not the result of a conscious effort. On the other hand, we have cognitive valences, which are thoughts about outcome values produced by a cognitive regulation system, and they require active reflection. If you do not reflect on your activities, you have only your affective regulation to navigate on. These two interact, and are combined on a common scale, which we call valence appraisal. Then we distinguish between personal and non-personal cognitive valences. Most of the time, personal cognitive valences are important, but there are also many cases where not only profit for the person, but profit for other people than the person are important motivationally. And we only have to think about parents, teachers, to know that's true. And it's important. And they are important, those motivations. The second problem is the distinction between approach and avoidance motivation. That's not really a problem. It's an accepted distinction. So I can be rather brief about it. Approach motivation shows more activation in the left hemisphere, and avoidance motivation more activation in the right hemisphere. Approach motivation is about enrichment, about getting things done, and that's generally a pleasant activity. It's about thriving. Avoidance motivation, on the other hand, is about maintenance of the status quo, and that can be, generally, is stressful. It's about surviving. You can do that in two ways. You can attack or fight, or you can flee or withdraw. So we have now six types of valences, which are relatively independent. Positive and negative, affective and cognitive, and with the cognitive valences, personal and non-personal. We have also what is also important are task-specific, what we call task-specific antecedents. All theories identify competence as an important motivational factor. Self-determination theory adds autonomy and relatedness, and the theory of planned behavior adds subjective norm. Subjective norm is the tendency to abide by the normative views of other people in the action context. The other aspects could be distinguished in a personal and a contextual aspect. With autonomy, we have then sense of personal autonomy, which is the question, do I drive this activity or am I driven? The contextual aspect is perceived freedom of action. Do I have decision power in choosing and performing an activity? Competence is divided in sense of personal competence. Do I have the capacities to perform this activity? And perceived external support, which is the capacity of the environment, so to speak, to abstract or to be conducive to my performance in that environment. I don't think it's useful to distinguish a contextual facet of relatedness, so we distinguish there only sense of personal relatedness. To what extent am I connected to other people in the action context? So that brings us to our full model. And initially we thought that all task-specific antecedents would influence all valences that could be possible. And these valences are combined on a common scale, valence appraisal, and that leads to readiness for action. Some theories assume direct influences from, for instance, the theory of planned behavior assumes an influence from subjective norm to readiness for action. Some expectancy value theories assume an influence from competence, and that's feasibility appraisal in our case, to readiness for action. So we have included these as dotted lines. Now, that brings us to our empirical explorations. I'm not going to present all of them, but I do that exemplary with some of them. Our approach, we had a general approach, and that included identification of certain different variants of activities, and then we asked whether motivational data for these activities could be modeled according to the unified model, and specifically whether we needed different models, and if so, how would these models differ. In most of our investigations, these activities were professional learning activities of teachers, which were judged in foresight. So we had scenarios or vignettes which described the activities. We asked teachers to read them and to imagine that they were going to be part of that activity in the very near future. And then the question was, how would you judge these activities in several motivational aspects? In full, we had 14 variables, since six of them were task-specific antecedents, sense of personal autonomy, perceived freedom of action, sense of personal competence, and so on. And we had eight types of valences: positive affective valence, and negative affective valence, with affective and cognitive, and the positive cognitive valences and negative cognitive valences. And these cognitive valences were divided in valence for the person, for the student, and for the school, as our subjects were always teachers. We translated these variables in one item per component and put a bipolar 7-point scale between them. For instance, sense of personal autonomy, I would have the feeling that I participated in such an activity only because I had to, versus only because I myself wanted to. Positive affective valence, during preparation and execution of such an activity, I would have seldom or never, or very often, a positive feeling, and so on. We analyzed these data using structural regression modeling. We used conformity factor analysis to determine the difference between activities, and that was always the case. So in those analyses, we analyzed the relations between components in several structural regression models, one for each activity. We used a type of analysis which is called model generation by Kleine. In these models, we had no manifest data on valence appraisal. So we modeled valence appraisal as a latent factor with valences as indicators. Okay, one of these studies involved professional learning activities about ICT use. And we distinguished here between two types of ICT use. The first was teaching supportive ICT use, and the second was learning supportive ICT use. And we derived the distinction from the literature on ICT use by teachers, where these two types are called traditional versus innovative ICT use. So we pinpoint that difference down to ICT use as a means of teaching in the hands of the teacher, and ICT use in the hands of the students as a means of learning. Again, we gave them a vignette that is literally described here, and we asked teachers how they would be motivated by those types of activity, if they would participate in it. So we have here readiness for action, sense of personal autonomy, perceived freedom of action, perceived external support, sense of personal competency, subjective norm of colleagues, and then all valences, positive affective valence, negative affective valence, three types of positive valences, and three types of negative valences. The circles indicate the relations in terms of the means of these variables, and the connections show the relations. Green, of course, positive relations, and red, negative relations. They are different, as you can see. For instance, perceived freedom of action appears to be scored higher in the teaching supportive ICT use case than in the learning supportive case. Presumably because they think, I'm going to use those instruments, and so I have more freedom of action there than in the other case, but the students is going to use those instruments. So there are all kinds of differences, and I'm not going to explain them all, but there are also a difference in relations between them, and the relations are stronger in the learning supportive case, and I presume that might be because they are not that familiar with those that type of use of ICT, which creates some kind of halo effect. So we created two models depicted here. I'm not going to explain them in detail. But on the bottom, we have task-specific antecedents. We have relations with valence, all valence in the middle, and the valence appraisal factor, which leads to readiness for action. I have extracted parts of these models, and I'm going to discuss those parts to indicate the differences and the resemblances between them. This is a table that represents the relative importance of valences. So these are the paths between the valences and the valence appraisal factor. And we see there is a less limited role of effective valences. They are not as important as the positive cognitive valences. They are more important. That's a pattern that we have seen in almost all of our studies. But there is also a difference, and the difference is a reversal of a pattern that we see in the teaching, ICT use for teaching. There we see that the personal negative cognitive valences are more important than the non-personal cognitive valences. And that pattern is reversed in the ICT use for learning. What does it mean? In this case of ICT use for teaching, the teacher has to invest in his in that activity. He has to learn how to use these ICT means. So the burden is on him, less on the student or the school. In the case of ICT use for learning, they think that the burden is on the student or the school, and not so much on the teacher himself, because he is not going to use these means. He is going to do other things he doesn't know about, but he thinks there's less burden for him. There's a burden for the student, maybe not so much in terms of learning, but more in terms of the dangers that are lurking on the internet when students are going on their own looking for information on the internet. And for the school, it's a strong investment to make to create an infrastructure that is adequate for that type of ICT use. Take a look. Yeah, that's okay. Sense of personal autonomy. We have here the relations of sense of personal autonomy with all valences and with readiness for action. Here beneath. Sense of personal autonomy is, in our studies, always related to the valences, so all valences, almost all valences, and that's a pattern that we have seen also in all our studies. The most important influence is on positive personal cognitive valences. There is also a direct influence on readiness for action. We did not predict that path. But it appears that to be feeling yourself as driving that activity is enough to be ready for action. And that's also what we have found in all our studies. Perceived freedom of action is also interesting. We thought it would influence sense of personal autonomy, and it does. But it also influences sense of personal competence in both cases, even stronger in the learning supportive ICT use case. So it seems as if teachers say, if I'm not allowed to do it as I want to, then I can't. There's a stronger influence on some valences in the ICT use for learning case. We had to include a path to the common factor, the valence appraisal factor, to account for that covariance between variables. So in that case, that's all. What that might mean is that they also think that I need to be on my own account to profit from it. Sense of personal competence is not very much influential in several of our studies, but that might be related to the fact that we are asking them to judge that in foresight, but we don't know exactly that. It's related to affective valences, and in the case of ICT use for learning, also in the on some cognitive valences. And in that case, there is also a direct influence on readiness for action. Again, they feel less confident about using ICT as a means of learning. Subjective norm is very important in the case of ICT use for learning. There is some influence on ICT use for teaching, but on all valences in ICT use for learning. So again, that seems to indicate that there must be a commitment of all colleagues to be able to make ICT use for learning a success. And there is also a direct influence on the readiness for action, which we have seen in all our studies. Not always, but it depends a lot on the type of activity. And I leave it to that. Now, we have been criticized for measuring affect using questionnaires that might involve a cognitive filter by which the actual affect is distorted. So we try to counteract that criticism by designing a study on implicit affect. This is only a pilot, so it's not a definitive study, but it's very informative. We devised six types of activities: small group instruction, meeting with parents, preparing lessons, supervision by the principal, observing a colleague, and registering pupil progress. These are normal activities of teachers. And we had only a sample of 60 teachers. We asked them to look at the picture, to read the description, and to imagine again that they were about to start that activity. Then we measured immediately implicit positive and negative effect using the IPANAT, Marcus Quirin. That is an instrument that uses nonsense words to, they are judged with affective adjectives. And the idea is that the effect that is called for by these activities is fused in that type of judgment. Positive words, negative words, and for each activity we had a different word. Then we used the same adjectives to describe the activity, whether that activity would make them feel sad or make them feel joyful, and so on. And from our model, we questioned only the valences. And here are the same pictures of relations and level of these variables, of our variables. Again, we have here readiness for action, and on this side, all valences, affective valences, positive cognitive valences, negative cognitive valences, and here we have implicit positive effect, implicit negative effect, explicit positive effect, and explicit negative effect. And to begin with, we did not see very much effect of implicit effect. There are some cases where we find something. For instance, the supervision of the principal, we found a relation of implicit negative effect on readiness for action. And that relation was positive, meaning that's a scary task, going to someone to look at you, whether you're doing well, is going to judge you. So I need to step up a bit to make that happen good. But there are also some resemblances between mainly a pattern with positive cognitive valences influential on readiness for action, as here. And that returns in several of these pictures. But overall, it shows that every activity shows its own pattern of relations. So, our conclusions from these studies is that the model does not provide deterministic relations. What effect a component has is dependent on the specifics of an activity. And the differentiation of different kinds of valences is helpful, as we have seen. They illustrate the intricate interaction between different aspects of the model. Subjective norm is an important addition, can be an important addition. It's not always important, but it can be. And furthermore, an important conclusion is also that task-specific antecedents can influence readiness for action directly, which we not always had foreseen, but also each other, which brings us strong doubts about the linear unidirectional sequence that the UMTM suggests. So, what are we going to make of all this? What conclusions can be drawn? Up to now, I've been arguing within the boundaries of motivation research. But the study on implicit effect brought us back to the literature on dual process theories of reasoning. And that encounter, together with our results, brought us to the conclusion that we have to put the UMTM in a broader picture. These dual process theories of reasoning are not so much about how many processes there are, and they're also not about reasoning per se. They are about the fact that we have two systems of behavior regulation. There are a lot of them. There are some characteristics written down. I'm not going to discuss them, but I'm going to take one of these, not these, but one system, one description of a dual system of behavior regulation, which is the one that is presented by Strack and Deutsch in another award-winning paper. And in that paper, there are two systems of behavior regulation. One is a reflective system, and the other is what they call the impulsive system. I would rather prefer the term associative system, but that's minor. The associative system contains nodes, network nodes, and these network nodes are can be affective nodes, and they can be cognitive nodes. So we do have also notions in that associative system. The principle of that system is activation. A perceptual imagination, for instance, can instigate or activate all kinds of nodes in that system. And along a cascade of influences activates behavioral schemata without a cognitive intervention. That is what can be done. For instance, you see a person, a woman, standing at the side of the pavement with a walking stick. And that sight instigates all kinds of notions in your head of old, deficient, handicapped, help her, feel good. And without further ado, you bring her to the other side of the street. Now, there is also the reflective system. And the reflective system works differently. The principle there is reasoning. And that same perception or imagination is categorized in that system and is reflected on, which brings you to factual and evaluative conclusions, brings you to behavioral alternatives, and which, by way of intending, can activate again those behavioral schemata. The same person standing on the side of the pavement, if you would have given it a second thought, you might have noticed that he was standing at a bus stop and did not want to cross the street at all. And that would have inhibited your original tendency to bring her to the other side of the street. The two interact heavily. You can become aware of your feelings and process them further in the reflective system, but then, but you can also become aware of notions in that associative system and process them further in the reflective system, which can lead to other implicit notions and so on. So we are going to embed the UMTM in a broader picture, and this is just a direction of thinking, not a finite system or something. We have in the associative system all kinds of factors. So affective valences, our affective valences are part of that associative system. They can become part of the reflective system by becoming conscious, but they can become conscious. You are aware of them, and you can further process them. Then, but then actually, they turn into cognitive valences because you are reasoning about them. So you are reasoning, you have cognitive valences about feelings then. Cognitive valences can also be part of, are also part of the associative systems, and they again can also become conscious, which can be further processed in the reflective system. Take our piano player I've talked about. He will have been aware of his yearning for contact with women, of course. He may also have been aware of the fact that he was using his piano play, rehearsal, as instrumental to that yearning for women. He may have been aware of that. But if he would have had more cognitive structures or more scaffold by external supporters, his parents or teachers, he might have had a better reflection on his situation, which might have led to the insight that he would have been better off by practicing his social skills instead of piano playing. Now, I'm not suggesting that reflection is always better. Sometimes you have no time to reflect and you have simply to handle. And the advice of those who investigate the associative system is always to think long about what you might do, but to decide based on what you feel about it. Okay, this is just an indication of the direction in which we want to develop the model further. And what's important is that, for us at least, that we think that such a model offers a place, I think, for all theories in motivation. Thank you very much for your attention. I think an implication would be, and we have actually done that, to create an instrument based on our valences and other aspects of motivation, and and that is what we have done in together with Alexander Minard, for instance. We made an online questionnaire to measure these kind of aspects, which would be indicative for how students are working within a project, which could be an instrument in the hands of teachers as a kind of signal system where things are going wrong, for instance.
A tool, a reflection tool. A
reflection tool, yeah. No, well, I just want to give it another name, because to intrinsic, everybody thinks of intrinsic motivation just doing something for the sake of an activity. And to me, that's meaningless. That sake of an activity You may not be aware of the sake of an activity, but that activity has always a function. And the function of an activity is integral part of that activity. You can't separate separable consequences. They are part of the activity. For instance, take the experiments where in self-determination theory where people are doing interesting learning tasks and work just to become wiser or learn something. And suddenly money is introduced as an incentive, and they know they get money for that activity. Now, that activity is no longer the same. It's a different activity, because the goal, the function of that activity, is to earn that money. And as soon as you have earned that money, you're ready. But if you want to learn more, you might be interested longer, as long as you are learning. Is that an answer to your question? In the first years of primary school, in kindergarten.
Kindergarten and first year.
Well, I've never thought about practical implications for kindergarten, but I presume that all kinds of differentiations that are existent with students at higher levels in types of motivation is not present yet. That's not developed so much. But I would guess that you can see whether children like to do what they are doing. And that that is, for me, enough, I suppose, at that level.
About the examples you gave to teachers about meeting with parents and things like that. So what level of familiarity with the task or knowledge of the tasks do students need to have?
I don't understand what you're saying, sorry.
Okay, so how much do students need to know about the activities to have a level of valence? So if I give students a completely new activity, like they don't know anything about it,
yeah.
How would this model work?
At that point in time, I don't think it's a completely new activity. Then students wouldn't know very much about what the consequences would be. So they would work or react on whether it might be interesting to try, and that's all. But gradually, then all kinds of experiences build up and produce all kinds of nodes in that active associative system, which are going to play a role in activities that are coming up.
Is this on? Yeah. Thank you for your talk. I really like how you try to unify a lot of those motivational theories. My question is that all of those motivational theories come with questionnaires and they measure self-reports and you know, you can always correlate all those data amongst each other and stuff. What kind of evidence do you have that your model, your kind of measurements are better than the other ones? And specifically, how do they relate to behavioral measures as some sort of ground truth?
First is whether our model is better. Our model isn't better. It's built on top of all theories. When you look at the operationalization of these measures, there are not many differences between different theories. So that's it's not better or worse, but the second part of your question, whether to use other kinds of measures than questionnaires, I would agree. But on the other hand, our first experience with implicit affect shows that people normally are aware of what they are doing, are aware of their feelings. If it's maybe it's when we have strong effects, for instance, that are not socially acceptable, then questionnaires become problematic. And we see that in research on prejudice, for instance. And there, those implicit effects are evolved more or less in that type of research. But normally, people are aware of what they want, what they do, and what they not fully, but there's also a reasonable level of awareness. But I would agree that we need other types of instruments as well, and we have seen in several sessions in this conference that. A lot of indicators coming available that we can use in the future. So the situation is growing.
I would like to thank you all for being here. If you have the time, you urgently should read his paper. It's highly interesting. So it's the award-winning paper from last early conference. Really go back, read the paper. It's such a high complex model. It's always good to read it. After hearing it, read it again. I wish you all a great day. See you tonight at the gala dinner and all the others tomorrow. And maybe at some of the other conferences. Take care.